Broadcasting from the studios of WKEN, where every day it's the weekend. It's the Ken Calvert Show with your host, Ken Calvert.
Hi, everybody, and welcome to the frigid studios of WKEN, where every day it's the weekend. And welcome to the Ken Calvert Show podcast. Oof, I'll tell you what, it's about this time of year, late February, that you start to say, no mas, no mas, get me out of here. I would love to spend like the entire month of March in Florida. Got a couple of buddies that do it that way. Man, that seems like the right thing to do right about now. But I'm happy to be here. Hope you're doing well out there, my friends. And today I have an interview up close and personal with a dear friend of ours that we lost, gosh, how many years ago? I'll look it up for you while we're doing this here. Glenn Frey. Talking about Glenn Frey. It's with a heavy heart that I share this one with you. I was old friends with Glenn Frey. We probably crossed paths in high school, but we maintained a close relationship, even though he moved out to the West Coast, but I would see him whenever he came back into town. We lost Glenn just over 3 years ago, January 18th, 2016. It was one of those, I remember exactly where I was when I heard the news days. Remember that? Jimi Hendrix, Keith Moon, Kurt Cobain, Jim Morrison, Janis Joplin. Obviously, John Lennon was another big one. I'm old enough to remember John F. Kennedy, the Challenger. So many events in our lives leave this lasting impression in our hearts and on our minds and in our souls. But boy, I'll tell you what, that was really, really a tough one. Sam Kinison was another one. Tom Petty, absolutely shocked when I got the news about Tom Petty. But I digress, and let's get back to Glenn Frey. This was an interview that I did back in 2012, going back to, I think it was April of 2012. Bringing you up to speed just a little bit on this, a year ago in January of 2018, Glenn's wife Cindy filed a lawsuit. I wasn't aware of this until I did some research against Mount Sinai Hospital in Manhattan over its treatment of Glenn before his death, 2016. Glenn was 67 years of age. Cindy is seeking $12 million for lost earnings to her family due to Glenn's death. She claims in 2015, the year before Glenn's death, the doctor caring for Glenn was negligent in treating Glenn's ulcerative colitis. I'm not a doctor, but that seems like something that should have been able to be treated. But things got out of hand, and we all know what the final demise of Glenn was. The interview you're about to hear today was recorded back in 2012. It was to promote his new release called After Hours, which was a giant step away from anything that the Eagles had ever recorded or any other early Glenn Frey solo LPs. Glenn had some great successes, you know, with solo hits like The Heat Is On, Smuggler's Blues, great stuff. But this was 180 degrees from anything Glenn Frey had ever recorded. The After Hours album has an interesting story behind it, as you will hear. Actually, the genesis of the album came from, of all places, Pebble Beach, the celebrity pro-am and actor-director Clint Eastwood. You'll hear that. I had no idea. That's a really compelling part, so be listening. I would like you to listen, and then also, when you're done listening, however you do it, get your music, that is to say, just check out a couple of tracks from After Hours. Got a little Mad Men feel to it, and you'll see what I'm talking about when you listen to it. The Eagles remain out on the road. In fact, they're heading down under later this month, about the 26th, I do believe, in Auckland, New Zealand. And then they'll go and tour Europe through late June, and then, I mean, it just keeps going. For a band that would not go out for so many years, now they've been out for quite some time. As most of you know, Glenn's loss has left, in my mind, a gaping hole in the lineup. However, Glenn's son, Deacon, great surprise, sounds awesome, and my, how proud the old man must be. The billing for the band now reads, The Eagles, Don Henley, Joe Walsh, Timothy B. Schmidt, with Vince Gill and Glenn Frey. And to that I say, be well, my friends, and continued success. And Glenn, may you rest in peace.
Ken Calvert, how are you doing, man?
I'm fine, thanks. We live and die for Don Darrow High.
Oh, my God. Which is no more.
Yeah, now it's just Royal Oak High School.
I know.
Well, you know.
Well, that's all right.
For the good times. You know, that sort of leads me right into this. Glenn Frey, congratulations. New CD, After Hours. It's out 1 week from Tuesday, May 8th. And I absolutely fell in love with it because I love this style of music and I love the story behind it as well. So I'm going to get out of the way and let you tell us the story behind why you've been working on this for 2.5 years.
Well, Ken, it's great to be, you know, on with you. And, you know, best wishes to everybody back in Detroit. You know, this record, I've been thinking about making it for a long, long time. And fortunately for me, you know, my parents, who are both tougher than a $2 steak, are, my dad's 91 now and my mom's 87. I wanted to get this record and have this record done and present this record to them while they're still here to enjoy it. And a lot of the songs that I recorded were actually songs really from my youth, more the 50s and 60s, I realized as I started putting this record together. I just picked songs I liked. And then I started to realize that, yeah, no, a lot of this stuff is, you know, from 50s and 60s. Now, I used to play at the Pebble Beach Golf Tournament, the Pro-Am in February up in Northern California. Well, the potentate is Clint Eastwood, who is quite an audiophile, quite a music fan, quite a jazz aficionado. And you'd get this letter, you know, about a week before the tournament, and said, welcome, we're so glad you're going to be here. By the way, on Wednesday night, Clint would like you to show up and sing a couple songs at the volunteer party. And then it would say, please do one of your well-known hits and something from the 40s. You know, and I mean, literally, I went, oh, what? So I started singing this material at the volunteer parties. And one year I sang I Left My Heart in San Francisco. Then I sang I Want to Be Around. Then I sang the Good Life. I kind of have a range that's pretty close to Tony Bennett. So he was a good match for me. So I started singing these songs up in a Pebble. Now, at a different dinner party on a Friday night, Michael Bolton, who I know, comes up to me and says, hey, Glenn, I meant to tell you the other night, you sound really good singing that material. Your voice is well suited to it. Have you ever thought about making a record? And I said, well, you know, I have. I have. You know, I really have thought about it. Thank you. You know, I thought it was very nice of Michael. But then I said, okay. So I went in the studio when the tournament was over, and we went back to L.A., and I grabbed my two buddies from the Eagles band, Michael Thompson and Richard Davis, and we went in, and we cut I Want to Be Around, The Good Life, and we cut the Burt Bacharach, Hal David song, The Look of Love.
Yeah.
I always loved Dusty Springfield's version of the Stan Getz sax solo. So we cut these three songs. We just kind of did them demo, like, real fast. Just kind of a pencil sketch, see what it might sound like. And it sounded really good. I mean, you know, we all looked at each other, and believe me, my buddies, you know, they'll tell me, you know, if it's, you know, you know, off base. But we all felt that it sounded really pretty good. So then we said, well, let's record some more of this stuff. Let's start reaching out. So then I did, you know, I cut a couple of Dinah Washington songs, and I love Dinah. And I don't think many people recognize her the way they recognize Billie Holiday and you know, some of the other female vocal, Ella Fitzgerald, Sarah Vaughan. But I cut a couple of Dinah Washington songs, and then I said, you know, I'm just going to cut anything that sounds good with piano and voice. That's going to be my criteria. It's not going to be 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s. So then I cut Caroline No. Then I cut a Randy Newman song, The Same Girl. You know, I started trying, you know, I cut a Ray Charles song from his country album, and I just started trying all this material, and eventually, you know, we got to where we looked around and said, geez, we got a lot of songs here.
Mm-hmm.
And so we basically, that's how we made this record. We kind of put it together like a jigsaw puzzle, very methodically, piece by piece, song by song. It wasn't like I hired some arranger to cut 10 songs for me in 2 different keys so I could come in and sing them in 3 days.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, it's not that sort of record at all. This was a very, like, a lot of love, a lot of care.
Then it begs the question, hopefully either sent it to or sat down with your folks, and they said, you done good?
Yeah.
Yeah?
That's exactly right. They love this record, and they followed it. I sent them stuff from the early demos to rough mixes from a year ago to now finally the record is finished, and, they have it, I feel very lucky that I can share that with them.
Yeah, I just
my sincere hope, Ken, by the way, I made this record just because I love this music. It really is more about the music than it is about me,
mm-hmm.
and I feel like I'm just sort of, a musical historian here, and my hope is that, among the millions of legions of Eagles fans that there are around the world, if a smattering of them happen to buy this record just out of curiosity and, start playing it, I think they'll be in for a big surprise.
I think some very curious things could occur, be you single or married or otherwise.
Well, that's right. It just might help, put a little fairy dust in the air there, a little magic.
This wasn't...
But it's funny, Ken, that you mentioned that, because that's another reason why I made this record. It was sort of like, I want this record. I want my friends to play it if they're on a car trip with their wife.
Mm-hmm.
They're staying home all day because it's a rainy day, and they're going to light a fire and put this on, or it's late at night, or having friends over for a little dinner party, and you plop on After Hours in the background, and everybody, kind of goes, oh, hey, that's good. Who's that? Glenn Frey? Really?
Glenn, this is so exciting to talk to you. Congratulations again. It's available. It's important to mention to that segment of the Eagles family, and I think there's going to be a larger segment than you give credit to. Amazon.com, Glenn Frey, AfterHours.com, the usual places. You also, like you mentioned, you cover Randy Newman, who I'm a fan of. And also, I just talked with Al Jardine from the Beach Boys, who are heading back out. You've covered the Beach Boys.
Brian Wilson is such an incredible songwriter, so gifted, the chord changes are fantastic, and I've always loved the Beach Boys. I'll always be a fan. They're probably the reason I moved to California. And they're celebrating their 50th anniversary. How about that?
Yeah, well, that's what I mean.
How about that? The Stones and the Beach Boys are both having 50th anniversaries. This is our 40th year, and we just said, maybe we should just stay out of the way.
Hey, Glenn, let me ask you this, a couple of quick things. Again, I want to mention Glenn Frey, my guest, originally from our area, Royal Oak, and, of course, the family. I'm so glad to hear that your family and your mom and dad are still doing well. It's Glenn Frey, After Hours. And it's available in stores on Tuesday, so we look forward to that and you guys picking it up. But aside from that, the Eagles are doing well. Can I ask you a couple of quick Eagles questions?
Yeah, we played. We're not doing a lot of performances right now. We went, we went around the U.S. twice with Long Road Out of Eden, so we're on a little bit of a break from that. What we're working on is a 2-DVD history of the Eagles with Academy Award-winning documentary filmmaker Alex Gibney.
Mm-hmm.
We were looking for somebody to do this documentary. And, they kept sending me guys, and it was like sort of like, well, this guy did the one on the Grateful Dead, and this guy did It's Gonna Get Loud, and this guy did that, and this. I said, listen, I don't care about music. Send me the guys that were nominated for the Academy Award for Best Documentary the last 5 years. I want to see that. So I looked at the reels, and the work by this guy, Alex Gibney, was so compelling, and he was such a great storyteller. And I thought, this is what we need. We need a great storyteller to tell the story of the Eagles. So we have 2 DVDs. The first DVD covers from 1970 to 1980, and the second DVD covers from 1994 to the present. So we're working hard to try to see if we can get that thing ready for Christmas. Beyond that, You know, there's a couple other things we're thinking about. We don't really know if we're going to tour yet again, although we're playing a few dates, like we're playing Jazz Fest next month in New Orleans and a couple shows in Atlanta to kind of prep for to get ready for that.
Yeah, I saw that.
But we don't, you know, we go year by year. And, you know, and then we sort of do what feels right, because we've learned with the Eagles that you can't force anything. You know, we tried to record when we weren't ready to record. They tried to get back together when we weren't ready to get back together. So we sort of learn now, you know, the stars line up. Here's what we're supposed to do. So this year is kind of a woodshedding year for us. Like I said, we're working on the documentary, and, you know, maybe there's a possibility. I'd love to do a tour that was the history of the Eagles.
Oh God!
That we could come on stage and up on a black screen. It would say 1971.
Wow.
And then we would, you know, be sitting on stools or something in a circle, working on Take It Easy, and just kind of tell our story in a chronological order. But that's also something that would probably. That takes a lot of preparation and a lot of production. We have a whole. That's something I think that might occur next year.
That would be an entire semester, if not an entire year of a class. I would not be late for that class, Glenn. Real quickly, three quick questions. Talk to Seeger at all?
I haven't, but I heard he went back on the road and he was great.
He was tremendous. He was absolutely great, and he's guaranteed a new record by September 26th.
Oh, that's fantastic.
So we're very, very excited about that. And finally, I got in trouble with Don Henley a number of years back. I said, and I wasn't going Barbara Walters, but I said, happiest you've ever been, Don? And he said, what are you, Oprah? And I said, so I'll ask you, one of the happiest stages of your life right now?
Oh, I think so.
Yeah?
I think so. I think I've got I think I've got some things in perspective now. I think for example, all the guys in the band, you know, I think we understand each other a lot better, and we're more accepting of who the other guys are and how we can make it work. So we sort of got the mothership, that's the Eagles, and the mothership's fine. And then we're kind of going out and doing other things. And this is, so I'm very happy to share After Hours with everybody. And, like I said, if they want to know more about the record, if you go to glennfryafterhours.com, There's sort of the story of making of this record, and I think that'll, you know, shed a lot of light on the project.
All right, well, I know you've got to get on, pardon the pun, Route 66.
Yeah, baby.
Glenn, thanks so much for joining me. It's a pleasure to chat with you, man. It's been way too long.
Hey, Ken, it was great talking to you, and God bless Detroit, Michigan.
All right, thank you so much. Hey, finally, did you ever go to the Grand as a kid?
Yes, I did. I saw the Grateful Dead there.
Okay. Did they bring the goats and go on forever?
No, but they did go on forever.
Glenn, peace. I love you and be well, okay?
Thanks, Ken.
All right, be good now. Bye-bye.
Your buddy misses you.
You can subscribe to the Ken Calvert Show podcast on Apple iTunes, TuneIn, Stitcher, Spotify, or iHeartRadio. It's also available by going directly to www.thekencalvertshow.com. You can reach Ken at kencalvertpodcast@gmail.com. The preceding program is the property of Ken Calvert and may not be rebroadcast without the written permission of Ken Calvert.